clear? So dapple-dapple reaction is a temporary force, a temporary attractive force which is going to exist between the two particles. That is one thing else, that these particles, since they are a huge number of particles, so this dipole-dipole interaction is going to be existing every time. It is going to be always there. So that is what we have as the dipole-dipole interaction, or the induced dipole interaction. Now, once we have talked about this dipole-dipole interaction, this induced dipole interaction, which is the weak van der Waals force, we get along with another one. This is what we call as dipole-dipole interaction. You can even say this is permanent dipole. Permanent dipole interaction. There are still some people whose mics are not muted. I would request them to mute the mic, because otherwise there is a background noise coming in. Yes, thank you. Okay, so we have the dipole-dipole interaction. Dipole-dipole interaction is going to be the permanent dipole, the substances which have permanent dipole, something like HCl, something like HBr, something like acetone, something like HCN. All these substances have permanent dipole interaction. These all are called the polar molecules. The interaction between the polar molecules is called the permanent dipole-dipole interaction. Then we have another forces, what we call as dipole-induced dipole forces. That is, we have one substance which is already a permanent dipole, and there is another substance which is not a dipole. So this permanent dipole is able to induce a dipole moment into a non-permanent dipole, non-polar substance. And a typical example of that would be that when noble gases are dissolved in water, or when noble gases interact with water, water, which is a dipole, induces dipole moment in a noble gas atom, something like maybe xenon. So water is able to induce the dipole moment in xenon, and then there is an interaction between water and xenon. This interaction between water and xenon is termed as the dipole-induced dipole interaction. So that is what we have as the dipole-induced dipole interaction. Clear? Okay, fine. Okay, so that is what we have as dipole induced dipole interaction. Nena, there is some problem with your connection, I believe. Okay. Now, the next force we are going to have is what we call as hydrogen bond. Please understand, hydrogen bond also turns out to be under the dipole-dipole interaction. Nena, please switch off your mic. Okay.
Okay. So
here we have hydrogen bonds. Hydrogen bond, first of all, you need to understand the condition of hydrogen bond. I am going to give you just one line of hydrogen bond, and that is, it is the interaction. Hydrogen bond is the interaction between the hydrogen attached to a very electronegative atom. It's an interaction between the hydrogen attached to a very electronegative atom, which is generally fluorine, oxygen, or nitrogen, and an atom having a very high negative charge, very high negative charge, and at least one lone pair. And that again is fluorine, oxygen, nitrogen, and in this case, it could even be chlorine. Please understand there is a difference between electronegative and negative. In fact, electronegative and negative are opposite of each other. If we have some substance having a negative charge, it's not going to be electronegative. Electronegative is electron deficient. On the other hand, negative is electron rich. So that is what we have as the negative and electronegative. But the species which are going to be behaving in this hydrogen bond, being utilized in hydrogen bond, they are going to be electronegative, and then they get a negative charge. Nena, please switch off your mic again. Okay. So that's what we have as electronegative and negative. So this is what is going to be hydrogen bond. Now, this hydrogen bond is a kind of dipole-dipole interaction only, but this dipole-dipole interaction is much stronger as compared to the simple dipole-dipole interaction. Further, hydrogen bond has one more property. It is directional. So the dipole-dipole interaction is directional. Is it clear? Just a minute. Okay, just a minute. One thing I'm doing more. Okay, so that's what we have as the hydrogen bond. Now, having talked about the hydrogen bond, now we are going to talk about the thermal energy. Now, this thermal energy is actually termed as the kinetic energy. Now, this thermal energy is the temperature. More the temperature, more is the thermal energy, and the thermal energy acts exact opposite to the attractive forces. The attractive forces, they try to get the particles close to each other, whereas thermal energy tries to get the particles away from each other. There are three kinds of motions that we include in the thermal energy. One is called the vibrational. Second one is called the rotational. And the third one is called the translational. So these are the three kind of thermal energy, and obviously thermal energy depends on the temperature. As the temperature increases, the thermal energy will keep on increasing. Now these are the two forces which are going to act against each other. They are acting opposite to each other. Now these forces, the resultant of these forces is going to decide what the state of the substance is. If the interactive attractive forces, the intermolecular interactions, they are going to dominate, then the substance is going to become solid. And if the thermal energy dominates, then in that case the substance is going to be a gas. And if they are just going to balance each other a little bit, then in that case it's going to be a liquid. Nana, you have by mistake sent me an image. Okay. So that's what we're going to be, a predominance of thermal energy is going to make it a gas. So it is going to be the attractive forces and the thermal energy relation that's going to tell us whether it's a gas, liquid, or a solid. So now let's get along with the gaseous state. We have moved on to the gaseous state. When we talk about the gaseous state, first of all, we need to remember something called the elemental gases. We are going to talk about certain substances which are going to exist as gases. Now, out of entire substances in the periodic table, we have just these gases. So these are 11 gases that we have. Okay, so these are just the gases that we have. Hydrogen, nitrogen, these are the 12 gases that we have in the periodic table. Rest of it are solids. There are only two liquids in the periodic table. Remember, there are only two liquids in the periodic table. You might be tempted to say more than two liquids, but we are going to talk about the temperature as 298 Kelvin. So if we consider the temperature as 298 Kelvin, we have only two liquids. One of the liquid is bromine and the other liquid is mercury. Rest of all substances are solids other than these 12 gases. All the others are solids. So that is what we have as elemental gases. Obviously, we have a lot many other gases which are not elements, but which are going to be the various molecular gases like methane, like carbon dioxide. But the elemental gases which we have are these 12. So once we have talked about these elemental gases, now let's talk about certain measurable properties of the gases. What are the properties that we can measure? Now, when we talk about these measurable properties, first of all, the property becomes the mass of the gas. Obviously, mass can be represented, mass can be measured easily. Now, talking about the mass, we are just going to talk about a little about the units of the mass. We have the units of mass as kilogram. Those are the most used units. Then we have something like grams, and then we have milligram. Obviously, we know how to convert them into each other, but still, I'm going to tell you that we talk about 1 kilogram. 1 kilogram is equal to 10 raised to power 3 grams, which in turn becomes equal to 10 raised to power 6 milligrams. These conversion factors, although they are quite easy, but they are responsible for many of the silly mistakes. So here we can say 1 gram is equal to 10 raised to power 3 milligrams. So these are the conversion factor when we talk about the mass of the gas. Then we have something called the volume of the gas. Volume again. Please remember, the volume of the gas is actually the volume of the container in which the gas is put. So, volume of a gas is actually the volume of the container in which the gas is put. So, when we talk about the volume, here again we have the units. One unit is called meter cube. Then we have something called decimeter cube, then something we have called the liter, then we have the centimeter cube, then we have the milliliter. That is what we are going to see. I don't know whether you are going to have the confusion in that or not, but here what we find is that there are certain relation with them. Some people do make a mistake. Meter cube is the biggest unit here. 1 meter cube is equal to 10 raised to power 3 decimeter cube, which in turn is equal to 10 raised to power 3 liters. which in turn is equal to 10 raised to power 6 centimeter cube and is equal to 10 raised to power 6 milliliter. So what you can understand here is that 1 decimeter cube is exactly equal to 1 liter, while 1 centimeter cube is exactly equal to 1 milliliter. It is not that they have become equal to that. It is there that we take them as equal. It has 1 decimeter cube has been exactly defined as equal to 1 liter. That's the conversion of the two units. So that is what we have as the volume of the gas. Then we have something called the pressure of the gas. Pressure of the gas is measured by a device called barometer. Then we have something called manometer. Manometer is the device which is normally used to measure the pressure of a gas container, gas in a simple container. It is attached to that. It's a simple device. It simply consists of a tube filled with mercury. There are two kinds of manometer. One is called the open-end manometer and another one is called the closed-end manometer. So open-end manometer is going to measure the pressure of the gas in comparison to the external pressure, while closed-end manometer is going to measure the absolute pressure. So that's what we have as manometer. Now, when we talk about the units of pressure, obviously we have something called atmosphere. Then we have something called bar. Then we have mmHg. We can even have centimeter of mercury. And then we can have something called the torr. And then we have something called the pascal. Now, out of these, bar is what we term as the standard unit, and pascal is what we call as the SI unit. Now, what we have is the relation between them. Atmosphere is the biggest unit here. 1 atm is equal to 1.01325 bar. It's generally, it's enough to have it 1.01 bar, which in turn is equal to 760 mmHg, which in turn is equal to 76 centimeter of mercury, which is equal to 760 torr, and which is equal to 1.01325 pascal. So what you can understand is 1 bar is equal to 10 raised to power 5 pascals. So that is the relation between the various units of pressure. Now we have something called the temperature of the gas. When we have temperature of the gas, obviously there are three units. We have something like degree Celsius, we have something like Kelvin, and we have something like Fahrenheit. Now, degree Celsius is equal to Fahrenheit temperature minus 32 multiplied by 5 by 9. Although the conversion is not required, the questions are never asked, but it's nothing wrong in remembering it. While Kelvin is equal to the temperature in degree Celsius plus 273.15. Actually, this 0.15 is generally neglected. So it is, turns out to be just the temperature in degree Celsius plus 273. So that is what we have as the temperature of the gas. So these are the measurable properties. And then we have something like the density. The density of the gas is actually dependent on temperature and pressure. Temperature and pressure. For a fixed temperature and pressure, the density actually becomes directly proportional to the molar mass. Since you perfectly know, of course, we are going to do that in this chapter again. The Avogadro's law simply says that equal volumes of all gases contain the equal number of particles. So 1 mole of every gas at a given condition of temperature and pressure is going to have exactly the same volume. Since the molar volume remains the same, that is why we find that the density becomes directly dependent on molar mass. So that's what we have as the density of the gas. Now we are going to get along with the gas laws. While getting along with the gas laws, the first law that we talk about is termed as the Boyle's law. Boyle's law simply tells us that there is a pressure-volume relationship. That is, as the pressure is increased, the volume decreases, which says volume is inversely proportional to pressure. So when we make the graph of volume with pressure, it turns out to be a curve. What Boyle did was he changed the pressure on a particular gas and he measured its volume. But we remember very clearly that here, temperature and mass of the gas are kept constant. So temperature and the mass of the gas are kept constant. So that is how it becomes the Boyle's law. So Boyle's law gives us the relation between temperature and pressure. So here we get that since P, pressure is directly proportional, pressure is inversely, temperature, volume is inversely proportional to pressure. Here we get volume is inversely proportional to pressure. So we get PV is equal to a constant, which is written as P1V1 is equal to P2V2, which is equal to a constant, which we obviously in chemistry we write as K. So these are the graphs. If we make the graph of volume versus 1 by P, then in that case, it's going to be a straight line passing through the origin. Now then we have something called the Charles law. Charles law gives us the temperature volume relationship. It simply says that a constant pressure and mass, constant pressure and mass, the volume of a given mass of a gas varies as the absolute temperature, that is temperature in Kelvin. The volume of the given mass of the gas increased by 1 by 273 of its volume at 0 degrees Celsius for each degree rise or fall of temperature, provided the pressure is kept constant. That is, the volume at temperature T is going to be equal to the volume at 0 degrees Celsius plus temperature in degree Celsius divided by 273 multiplied by V naught, that is V volume at 0 degrees Celsius. This is going to be the equation that is going to be valid when we talk about the variation of volume with temperature in degree Celsius. And this is what initially Charles told. This is what initial Charles law is. Now, in this case, when we talk about the Charles law, this graph, this particular equation led to the derivation of the absolute temperature scale. If the V naught is the volume of the given mass of the gas at 0 degrees Celsius, the V1 is going to be 1 degree Celsius. This is the Vt, that is the volume at a temperature T. Now, looking at this equation that we have at T degree Celsius, could you just give me the volume of a gas using this particular equation? Could you give me the volume of the gases at these temperatures? Let's say at 273 degrees Celsius, 546 degree, 136.5, minus 136.5, and minus 273 degrees Celsius and minus 546 degrees Celsius. Could you just give me the volume of the gases at these temperatures? And this is what is going to be the equation that you are going to use. I'm going to write this equation once again here. It's going to be the volume at T is equal to volume at 0 degrees Celsius plus T upon 273 multiplied by volume at 0 degrees Celsius. So what do we get? If the volume is 100 milliliter at 273 Kelvin, 273 degrees Celsius, the volume would turn out to be 200 milliliter. At 546, it's going to be 300 milliliter. At 136.5, it's going to be 150 milliliter. At minus 136, it's going to be actually 50 milliliter. And theoretically speaking, at minus 273, it should be 0 milliliter. And at minus 546, it should become minus 100 milliliter. But then, negative volume is not possible. So Charles suggested that the temperature below, the temperature below minus 273 degrees Celsius is not possible. Now, this minus 273 degrees Celsius below which the temperature is not possible is considered the absolute zero of temperature. We can consider the temperature. We can measure the absolute value of temperature. So this is absolute zero. In fact, it's minus 273.15 degrees Celsius, which is absolute zero of temperature. So at T equal to minus 273 degrees Celsius, the volume of the gas becomes a zero. And below that, it should become negative since the volume cannot be negative. That is why the temperature below minus 273.15 degrees Celsius is not possible. So that is what we call as absolute scale of temperature. That is what we call as the Kelvin temperature. So this is what we have as a relation. Temperature in Kelvin is equal to temperature in degrees Celsius plus 273.15. Using that temperature, we get that V1 by T1 is equal to V2 by T2. That is, the volume is directly proportional to temperature in absolute. And that is V1 T2 is equal to V2 T1. That is equal to a constant. So that is the relation between the temperature and volume. So when we combine the Boyle's law and the Charles law, we get the combined gas law. Combined gas law is P1 V1 by T1 is equal to P2 V2 by T2 for constant mass. We keep the mass as a constant for this law. Just remember, we are not going to use the combined gas law also in any of the our calculation. We are going to use only the ideal gas law, which we are going to get discuss a little later. Now here we have Gay-Lussac's law of combining, Gay-Lussac's law, which is temperature pressure relationship. The Gay-Lussac's law simply says that if the volume and mass are kept constant, then pressure becomes directly proportional to the temperature in Kelvin. So pressure becomes directly dependent on temperature in Kelvin. That is what we have as the Gay-Lussac's law. So these are the laws. Now we just have another law, which we call as the Avogadro's law. Avogadro's law is quite simple, which simply says that equal volume of all gases under the same condition of temperature and pressure contain equal number of molecules. They contain the same number of particles. It follows from Avogadro's law that the molar volume, the volume occupied by one mole of each substance in the gaseous state, which is equal to 22.414 liters at NTP. Now, please understand that these temperature and pressure, these standards are being changed. So what we have the standard now is 1 bar and 273 Kelvin. So this is the STP, which is the being taken nowadays. That STP becomes 22.7 liters. So NCERT has used 22.7 liters as the STP now. So this is what we are going to use in most of the questions in this book, in this lecture also. So that is what we have as Avogadro's law. Now we can combine the three laws. The Avogadro's law, Charles law, and Avogadro's law. We find the temperature, pressure, and number of moles. Okay. So we have the three things. We have V proportional to 1 by P at constant temperature and mass, which is Boyle's law. V is proportional to T, that is at constant pressure and mass, that is Charles law. V is proportional to N, that is the number of moles, that is at constant pressure and temperature, that is Avogadro's law. And this is a simple statement in physics that if we have a quantity which is dependent on more than one quantity's independent quantities, then it depends on their product as well. So having them on the product, we have the volume PV is equal to NRT, or V is proportional to NT by P. Now, R is called the gas constant. Now, please understand there are two kinds of constant. One is called a constant, normal temporary constant. Another one is called the universal constant. Universal constant are those the value of which does not depend on any of the physical conditions. You can have any temperature, you can have any pressure, you can have any gas. The gas constant is not going to change. That is what it's called as a universal constant. Another universal constant is gravitational constant, which does not depend on condition. But the value of universal constant depends on units. Units of measurement. If we change the units of measurement, then in that case, the universal constant value is going to change. Clear? So that is what we have as the universal constant, the change in the values. Now this R is called the proportionality constant, and this is called a universal gas constant, and this equation is called the ideal equation, ideal gas equation. Now here we have certain values of universal constant. I'm going to write these values once again. You need to remember these values. Here already they are written on the slides. I'm going to write it once again in the various units. R is equal to 0.0821 when the pressure is in atmosphere, the volume is in liter, the amount is taken in mole, and the temperature is in Kelvin. Then R becomes equal to 0.0831 when the pressure is in bar, the volume in decimeter cube, although decimeter cube and liters are exactly the same, the amount again is in mole and the temperature is in Kelvin. Now this becomes equal to 8.31 when the pressure is in Pascal, volume is in meter cube, amount again in mole and the temperature in Kelvin. Now this actually becomes 8.31 joules with mole inverse, Kelvin inverse. And if we are going to take it in the calories, of course joules can be converted into calories, then in that case it's actually 1.986 calories per mole per Kelvin, but we generally take it as simply approximately 2 calories per mole per Kelvin. So that is what we have as the gas constant. So this is what we have as gas constant. This is what we have as gas law. And now we are going to have the small calculations. Calculate the volume occupied by 1 mole of an ideal gas at 273 Kelvin 1 atmosphere, 273 Kelvin 1 bar, 298 Kelvin 1 atmosphere, and 298 Kelvin 1 bar. What you can do is you can quickly see, take the calculators and just calculate these values. Actually, it is nothing more, that nothing about it. It's going to be, we have the volume is equal to, volume is equal to nRT by P. Volume is equal to going to be nRT by P. And P is going to be 1 in all cases, temperature is going to be different, and you will have to change the value of R. Okay. So, could you give me the values? Okay, fine. I'm going to write the values. I hope you have calculated them out. The very first thing, it turns out to be 22.4 liters. I'm giving the approximate value, the rounded off value. Here it turns out to be 22.7 liters. Here it comes out to be, I believe, near about 24.4 liters. And here it comes out to be 24.6 liters, or maybe a little bit of 7 liters. So these are the values, and this value is what we consider as the standard. Or rather, I should say the word called STP. Okay. Now, there is a something called natural ambient temperature and pressure. Ambient temperature and pressure. Now, natural ambient temperature and pressure is something like 1 bar and 298 Kelvin. So that is natural ambient temperature and pressure. Now, let's have a cylinder which contains helium. Now, this is a question here you have. Could you give me the answer to these questions? I believe we have a chat option in which you will be able to give me the answer. Could you just give me the answer on the chat? each one of you for this question. Obviously, this needs to be an interactive session. It can't be just one way, one directional session. Could you give me the answer? You are going to obviously use the equation as PV is equal to P1V1 by N1T1 is equal to P2V2 by N2T2. That is the equation which we are going to use. So Kushvendra is typing, but I am not getting the answer. No, the final temperature is not given. You have been given just the pressure. You have been given the melting point. You have been given the pressure, what it can tolerate. And we are just heating it. Final temperature, I don't know. You have to tell me whether it's going to explode or it's going to melt. I don't want an answer as maybe. I want the answer as what exactly it's going to be. Only Kushvendra has even tried to give the answer. Rest of the people are not even going to give me the answer. B, explode. Guneev says it's going to explode. Okay, fine. Anybody else? Give me the answer. Now, Asta has given me a confirmed answer that it's going to explode. Ramkrishna Mishra says, B, again, explode. Good, good, good. There are so many others who have yet to give me the answer. Rakshan, again, Kartikeya, yes, explode. Good, good. Yes. Okay, so everybody has given me the answer is explode. I believe I don't need to explain now that why it explodes. Okay, okay, okay. Anmol has given it to be explode. So everybody has given me the answer as explode. Does anybody have any confusion so as to why it would be explode? Okay. What we are going to do here is we have already, we know what the pressure, initial pressure is. Initial pressure is going to be, let's say we have the 5 bar is the initial pressure. Then we have initial volume. We are going to take it as V. We don't need the volume here. And then the number of moles are going to remain constant, N, and the temperature, initial temperature is 300 Kelvin. Now it can be solved in two ways. One, we can measure, we can calculate the pressure at the melting point. So what we are going to do, we are going to calculate the pressure at the melting point. The volume again remains a constant. The number of moles remain a constant and the temperature becomes 2000 Kelvin. Now, if we measure the pressure at the melting point, it turns out to be 33.3 bar. Now, this 33.3 bar is more than the pressure that the cylinder can tolerate. The cylinder can tolerate the pressure of only 25 bar, but the pressure at the melting point is 33.3 bar, which is much greater than that. So before it reaches the pressure at the melting point, it is going to explode. Otherwise, what we can do is we can actually calculate the temperature at the explosion pressure. Here we are going to keep the pressure as 25 bar, volume is going to remain the constant, number of moles are going to remain the constant, and the temperature is going to be found. So when we find the temperature T2, we find that temperature T2 is equal to 1500 Kelvin. So at 1500 Kelvin, the cylinder is going to explode. So it is not going to go beyond that temperature. Before that, it's going to explode. So whether you talk about finding the pressure at the melting point or you find the temperature at the explosion pressure, you are going to get the right answer. So that is what we have as the question. Now, what is important is I'm just going to write a equation. See, we have just got the equation as PV is equal to NRT. Now, this PV is equal to NRT can be written as PV is equal to M by MRT, where small m is the mass of the substance and capital M is the molar mass. A little jugglery, it's going to become PVM is equal to small mRT. And a little bit more jugglery is going to make it PM is equal to small m by VRT. Now, the small m is the mass of the gas and V is the volume of the gas. So here, it becomes PM is equal to DRT. So it is the relation with the density. So these are the equation, but you can have the equation number one as this, equation number two as this, and equation number three as this. Then we can have a little bit more jugglery. What we can do is we have P1 V1 by N1 T1 is equal to P2 V2. By N2 T2, which is equal to the gas constant R. A little bit jugglery again, it's going to become P1 V1 capital M1 upon small M1 T1 is equal to P2 V2 capital M2 upon small M2 T2, and that's again going to be equal to R. So that's the relation between the mass and the molar mass and the rest of the things. And then we could even juggle this equation as P1 capital M1 upon M1 by V1 is equal to the density. So it is going to become D1 T1 is equal to P2 M2 upon D2 T2. And that's equal to R. Okay. So, having talked about that, now let's get along with the next question. These are the six equations. Let's say this is the equation number four. This is the equation number five. This is the equation number six. These are the equations which we have juggled up. Now, these are nothing but the juggling of the initial, the ideal gas law only. But these equations are going to be the one which we are going to use. So, talking about the next question. What should be the temperature so that hydrogen gas at 5 bar has the same density as oxygen gas at 300 Kelvin and 1 bar? I believe you are going to use the equation as P1 M1 upon D1 T1 is equal to P2 M2 upon D2 T2. And that's going to be equal to R. Could you just give me quickly the answer? Solve the equation and give me the answer. The very first thing, the densities are going to get cancelled out because densities are the same. Rakshan has got the answer. You can actually just give me the choice. That's A, B, C, D. Kartikeyan has given me the answer as A. Astha. Perfect. Anmol. Anushka, right? Shreyas, Soumya, right, everybody has got the answer as A, yes, Abhishek, Nayana, Guneev, Kushvendra, so, everybody gets the answer as A. Yes, the answer is A. No confusions with that. I don't suppose I have to explain this equation any further. Now let's get along with something called the word called payload. Payload is something like mass of the air displaced minus the mass of the balloon. We are talking about the payload of the balloon. Payload of the balloon is the mass. A balloon can carry over and above its own mass. Okay, that's what we have as something called the payload. Now, if we talk about the mass of the balloon and the payload that we are talking about, the payload actually becomes equal to the volume of balloon multiplied by density of air minus mass of material of balloon plus mass of gas filled in balloon. Okay, now let's have a simple question. Although this question appears to be quite a long one, it doesn't actually have any calculation. If you are able to write the expression clearly, if you are able to write the right expression, you are going to have the right answer. Can I get the answer? So when we try to solve this question, it's going to be something like the volume of the balloon into, we have payload, that's volume of the balloon into the density of air minus the mass of the material plus PVM, where P is the pressure, V is the volume, M is the molar mass of the gas, divided by RT. That's how it's going to be solved. Now, when we have this payload, the entire equation would turn out to be payload is equal to 1.2 multiplied by 3000 minus 100 plus pressure is 1.662 bar. I'm just putting the units as well. Multiplied by volume, that is 3000 into 10 raised to power 3 decimeter cube, multiplied by 4 into 10 raised to power minus 3 kilogram, divided by 0.0831 bar decimeter cube, Kelvin inverse, mole inverse into 300 Kelvin. That is going to be the expression. If we use this expression and try to calculate it out, first of all, we are going to cancel the dimensions so as to know whether the equation is dimensionally correct or not. So here it's going to be bar goes with bar. Decimeter cube goes with decimeter cube. Kelvin inverse goes with Kelvin. Mole inverse goes with mole inverse here. It's 10 to the power minus 3 mole inverse. So here it goes mole inverse with mole inverse. So we are left over with only the unit as kg. And here we can actually do the calculation. This 10 raised to power 3 goes with 10 raised to power minus 3. This 300 goes with 3000. 0.0831 goes with 1.662. It goes as 20. And so what are we left over with? It comes out to be, this is 3600 minus 100 plus 800. At least now give me the answer. Nobody has given me the answer as yet. I haven't solved the entire question. Rest. Yes, yes, yes. Anmol, now we have got the answer B. Where are the others? Rakshan. Yes. Soumya. Soumya. Anushka. Right. Nayana. Shreyas. Guneev. Abhishek. Ramkrishna. Kartikeya. So everybody is getting the right answer. That's going to be 2700 kg. Is there anybody who's not able to get the answer? Just ping me. If you have not been able to get the answer, obviously I have solved it. So it turns out to be 2700 kg. Anybody has any confusion in this question? Okay. Now let's get along with something called the Dalton's law of partial pressure. Dalton's law of partial pressure says the pressure exerted by a gas in a mixture of gases is known as its partial pressure. Now this is equal to the pressure the gas would exert if it was only gas in the container. The gas is not affected by any other gas present in the container. It exerts the same pressure. So that is what we have as the partial pressure of the gas. Okay. Now, We talk about the Dalton's law of partial pressure, the total pressure exerted by all gases in a mixture of non-reacting. Now that becomes non-reacting is an important word. If the gases are reacting, then in that case, whatever pressure we have initially kept, that's not going to remain valid. It's going to change. That is why we talk about only non-reacting ideal gases is equal to the sum of the partial pressure of each gas. So that is what we have as the Dalton's law of partial pressures. Okay. It states that at any specified temperature, the total pressure exerted by a gas mixture is equal to the sum of the partial pressure of the constituent gases. So that is what we have as Dalton's law of partial pressure. And in considering that, we can even have the partial pressure is, for any gas, the partial pressure of any gas in the mixture is equal to the mole fraction of the gas multiplied by total pressure. Is a mole fraction multiplied by total pressure. So here what we have as the Dalton's law of partial pressures. So we have a question. Calculate the partial pressure of each gas in a mixture containing equal masses of hydrogen, helium, methane, and oxygen exerting a total pressure of 5.4 bar. Could you give me the partial pressure of each gas? Give me the answer. Guneev, these all have the same mass. These don't have the same moles. So you need to say a little bit different. They don't have all the same partial pressures. They are going to have different partial pressures. No, it's not 5.4 by 37. No, it is not. I believe you are making a mistake in the molar masses. Hydrogen has a molar mass of 2. Helium has a molar mass of 4. Methane has 16. And oxygen is 32. Nope. Nobody has got the right answer as yet. Think again. No, Abhishek, it's not 4.12. See, first of all, we have to get the mole fraction. So what we do is let the mass of each gas be, you can take any value. You can take any value. Let's say X. Okay. 0.41. Which pressure is it? The pressure of the partial pressure of which one? Let the mass of each gas be X. Then the partial pressure of hydrogen, let's say partial pressure of hydrogen, will turn out to be X by 2 divided by X by 2 plus 0.2 is the partial pressure of which? No, 3.33 is not the answer for any of the gases. X by 2 plus X by 4 plus X by 16 plus X by 32. No, partial pressure of hydrogen is not 4.12. It is not 4.12. Multiplied by 5.4. But this question, the trick is all about the molar masses. And hydrogen, helium, methane, and oxygen, we don't need to tell you the molar masses. These are the molar masses which we expect that you are going to know. And maybe they give you the atomic masses. Hydrogen atomic mass is 1. Helium is 4. Methane is, carbon would be given 16. It's not 0.2 for helium. Partial pressure of hydrogen turns out to be 3.2. Partial pressure of helium comes out to be 1.6. Partial pressure of methane is 0.4. And partial pressure of oxygen is going to be 0.2. These are the partial pressures. Does anybody have any confusions in that now? Good. Fine. So that was the thing called the partial pressure. If anybody has any confusions anywhere, ask it now. Clear? Okay.
Sir, Kushwinder speaking.
Yeah, Kushwinder.
I was asking that I assume to be total. I assume the total mass to be 100 grams, and then sorted that all have equal masses, 25, 25 grams, and then I calculated moles. Then the mole fraction, is it correct?
Well, it actually absolutely does not make the difference because whatever mass you take, it's going to get cancelled out.
Okay.
If instead of X, you are going to put 25, that's what you are trying to do, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Exactly.
Put it 25, it's going to get cancelled out.
Yes, my answer was quite near about to you. That's why I asked.
Well, the answer cannot be near about to me. It has to be exactly me because there isn't any calculation involved in it. Everything gets cancelled
Okay.
out.
Okay, sir.
This is a peculiar question, and as you would have noticed, whatever question I have been giving to you, these questions are peculiar in the sense that they don't involve any of the calculations.
Yes, sir.
If you write the expression correctly, you will have to get the answer correct. There is no possibility that you don't get the answer correct because it doesn't involve mathematics. It just simply involves the formula. Put the formula, get the answer. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So here we have a simple question regarding the Dalton's law of partial pressure. Does anybody have a problem if we extend the class by 20 minutes since we had a little late starting today? Next class you are going to have is at 10 o'clock. So I believe 10 minutes duration would be enough for you to good. Thank you. So we are going to extend this class for 20 minutes, and this is going to happen only for once. Next time it's not going to be late. There were some technical things which I had to sort out in the beginning. Thank you. So let's get along further. So today we will be able to finish off the chapter. Okay. Yes, I have got the no sir from everybody. Thank you for that. Okay. Let's get along with something called diffusion. When you talk about the diffusion, it's called the net movement. Okay. Remember, this word net is extremely important. Most of the books, most of the people, they miss this net word. Remember, whenever there is a movement of particle, the particle movement is random. It is in both the directions. It's from the higher concentration to the lower concentration, as well as from the lower concentration to the higher concentration. So the particle movement is in both the direction. So here we are talking about the net movement. Whichever direction the particles are more, from there, the movement is more. So overall movement becomes from the higher concentration to the lower concentration. So that is what we have as the net movement of the particles from the region of their higher concentration or the higher partial pressure to a region of their lower concentration or lower partial pressure. This is what we term as diffusion. Is it clear? Now, diffusion is a passive process. Passive process means it's thermodynamically favored. Clear? In fact, if I little bit take along with the thermodynamics, it is entropy favored. Okay. In case of diffusion, the change in enthalpy is zero. It's 100% entropy favored. That is, diffusion leads to more of randomness, more of entropy. So that's what we have as a diffusion. Now, the Gram's law of diffusion simply states that the rate of diffusion of a gas is inversely proportional to the square root of its density, keeping the temperature and pressure constant. So the rate of diffusion is proportional to 1 by D. Okay. Now, we very well know that D is equal to Pm. By R by RT. Okay. So if I substitute the D by Pm by RT, I would simply get rate of diffusion is inversely proportional to rest of them being constant 1 by m. Now, please understand that this equation is valid at only a constant pressure and a constant temperature. Clear? So what we do is we make it like we take the ratios. We have R1 upon R2 becomes equal to the under root of 1 by D. So it is under root. So it is D2 by D1, the root, which is equal to under root of M2 by M1. That is the masses. This is the molar masses at constant temperature and pressure. Now, one thing I would like to tell you here, that this rate of diffusion, this rate could have different units, any units you can use. But while putting these rate in this equation, there are certain units which are allowed and certain which are not allowed. What are allowed? Rate could be in the moles per unit time. That is, we can talk about the diffusion of moles per unit time. It could be in volume per unit time. It could be in number of molecules per unit time. Okay, it could even be in length per unit time. Okay, but this rate of diffusion in this equation cannot be in mass per unit time. I don't say that you cannot be given the mass. You can be given the mass. But the problem is, if you are given the mass, you will have to convert it into volume or moles. You cannot use mass directly in this equation. So that is what you need to remember. That is, this rate has to be in moles, volume, or length, or maybe number of molecules. If it is given in mass, you will have to convert it. Okay? So that is what we have as Graham's law of diffusion. Now let's have this simple little question. Could you please solve it? Here, R of H2 upon R of O2. Perfect, perfect, perfect. Would be equal to under root of molar mass of O2 divided by molar mass of H2. Okay. So this comes out to be R of H2 divided by R of O2 is equal to under root of M of O2, that is 32, divided by M of H2, that is 2. Yes. Everybody has got the right answer? Good. So let's get along with the next question. Yes, the answer is B, and I'm not going to dwell on it. Let's get along with the next question. Okay. We have the next question in front of you. Could you give me the answer to that question? NB. So what's the answer of the next question, coming question, this one? Here again, it's B. Okay, let's solve it. Did you convert this mass into moles?
Yeah.
Okay, then we have 10 grams of oxygen and we have m grams of hydrogen. Now that's equal to 2 upon 32. Okay, and solve this question, this equation. Now I'm getting different answers. Kartikeya, don't ask me, tell me. Is it 1.25 gram? Is it 2.5 gram? Is it 40 grams? Is it 80 grams? The equation is written in front of you. So what do we get? We get 10 into 2 upon m into 32 is equal to 1 by 4. So m is equal to 10 into 2. Into 4 divided by 32. So what does it turn out to be? 2.5 grams. Is it clear? Does anybody have any problem in this question? I just told you that you are not going to use the mass. Okay, what you are going to use is the moles. See, I have a tendency to give very simple questions, but these questions tend to make you do silly mistakes. Okay, let's get along with the next question. Solve this question. Let's have this question, and I will suggest you that you please make the diagram. If you are not going to make the diagram, it's going to be extremely difficult for you to solve this question. Okay, Anmol. I would suggest, Anmol, you read the question carefully. Yes, I can explain. See, we have a tube. This tube has a length of 200 centimeter. This is 200 centimeter. Okay. Now from here, we have pumped hydrogen. And from here, we have pumped oxygen. Let us say the distance traveled by hydrogen is x. This is x. So this distance is 200 minus x. Okay. Now, R of H2 upon R of O2 is equal to X upon 200 minus X, which is equal to under root of the molar mass of oxygen, that is 32, divided by the molar mass of hydrogen, that is 2. Now, can you solve it? So the value of X turns out to be 160. Is that clear, everybody? Okay. Now let's get along with the kinetic theory of gases. Kinetic theory of gases would be, I believe you know, it considers the gas to be consisting of large number of minute particles. In fact, when we talk about the kinetic theory of gases, the postulates are absolutely simple. The first thing, the gas molecules are point masses. The gas molecules are point masses. That is, they have mass but no volume. Okay, that's the first thing. Second, no attractive forces. So these are the two dominant postulates of kinetic theory of gases. The gas molecules are point masses and they don't have any attractive forces. So that's what we have as the postulates. I believe these postulates you have already read through. Okay, and then there are third postulate is the temperature is a measure of kinetic energy of molecules, and then the pressure is due to the collision of molecules with the walls. That's what we have as the pressure. Okay. Now we have kinetic theory equation of a gas. Now kinetic theory equation of a gas says the expression of the three types of velocities. We have the root mean square velocity, we have the most probable velocity, and we have the average velocity. These are the three different types of velocity of a gas. I would suggest that we stop the class now and we can continue it tomorrow. A very small part is left, but stretching it is going to make it difficult for you to get along in the next class. So we are leaving the class now. I hope you had a nice session today and you were able to understand everything. My suggestion would be later on, you can just watch the video. You are going to get the video now. Everybody is going to get the videos. Okay, so everybody would be getting the videos and we'll meet tomorrow at the same time. No, a little earlier. We are going to start the class tomorrow sharp at 7 o'clock so that we don't need to extend it and you get proper rest between the two classes. Okay, bye-bye. Thank you. We'll meet tomorrow. Thank you, beta. Thank you. Bye-bye. You can just log out now. And you you can log in after 10 minutes. Well, you can just check the timetable. I believe the class is Kartike. Check it out. Class I thought is at 10 a.m. Check it out. Check it out. Oh, you would have missed the class then. Okay, bye-bye. Oh, no, not in 10 minutes. Yes. It's 10 a.m. I was a little confused. I thought it's just 10 minutes. No, it's going to be 1 hour, 10 minutes. You are going to log in at 9:50. Okay, then how do I stop the call? Okay, bye-bye.